que nos va a hablar de un examen que es ampliamente utilizado en los servicios de urgencia, pero quizás no del todo aprovechado. Dejamos con el doctor Suadron a la audiencia y nos va a hablar de TAC de cerebro. Sáquenle el jugo a la imagen.
Gracias. I'm so glad that there's a lot more people here than there were at 8 o'clock. It reminds me of home. And I'm also glad that we've spoken about penises for most of the day. Everyone here knows that I can't come without talking to you about head CTs. Okay, there's no way of escaping it. Because I think that head CT is a core skill. And if you work at Sodero de Rio, as I was a guest there for a while, it's very important to be good with head CTs. I consider head CTs to be similar to a chest x-ray or a bedside ultrasound in that there are many times where there is not sufficient time to get a radiologist's input. So I put it in the tier one of imaging studies that we have to actually be pretty facile with. Those of you that know me know that I think this is important core curriculum as well. This is the vehicle of the radiologist. And important features include the most recent Lexus model and daylight hours, okay? And you know the profession that you picked will leave you driving this. And that is a choice that you made. Now let's talk about some short cases that make clinical points that revolve around head CT. Now, there's some of the residents in the PUC program. This will be the second time for the first cases that you will see, so hopefully you'll get them right the second time around. First of all, I want to tell you that all three of these patients have a Glasgow coma score of 15. They're all alert and oriented. They all have normal neurologic exams. Two need to go home right away, and one needs to get a CAT scan. Which one? I want a show of clapping. How many people think number one? Clap. Number two, clap. No one thinks she needs a CT. Number three. It's a tie between number one and three. In fact, the right answer is number three. Number three has a raccoon's eye. And the significance of a raccoon's eye, which means that there is sparing of the eyelid, because the blood, it means that the blood that you see here is not coming from an injury to the eye, but rather is coming from a basal skull fracture and the blood is tracking forward. This woman is just suffering from what we call a black eye or periorbital ecchymosis from direct trauma to the eye. Because we think that this gentleman has sustained a basal skull fracture, and because we know that basal skull fractures are associated with very high rates of intracerebral hemorrhage, he must be imaged, even though he's got a normal neurologic exam. This shows you the base of the skull, and it shows you the manifestations of basal skull fractures at different levels. And these are things that you are familiar with, but I just wanted to clarify what specifically a raccoon's eye looks like. It doesn't mean that if someone has bruising here, that you don't do a CT, okay? They still might have an injury, but this definitely requires a CT. And so you can see that the battle sign reflects posterior fractures, and the ear is middle, and the nose is frontal. So there's the CT on that patient. You can see the skull fracture there. Okay, so that's the first one. And this is just a quickie, airhead. Okay, which is something that we call people with air in their head. Here's a case of, you know, Canada, where I used to work, there's a lot of, there's not so many shootings in Canada, but there's a lot of drinking and a lot of punching. And this is something that everyone needs to be able to recognize. When you get the CTs of the bones, when you look at the bone windows, you look carefully and you will see black specks. And air shows up best on bone windows on CAT scan. And so I think that this is important. And why is that important? Because if there's air in the brain, There must be a skull fracture. You've missed it, or at least you know the dura has been torn, and so this needs a neurosurgical referral. You guys like to play those games, right, where you clap? You like that? Maybe not? Too bad. Here's a fun game. Okay, you have to pick one of these CAT scans as your own. You can't pick none. You have to pick one. Which one would you rather have? Oh, what's that? Just a second. I guess just close this. Okay. So which one would you rather have? So everyone would rather have one. Clap your hands. Should I get a baseball bat out? No, make it happen. Okay, how many people? Number two, clap. Okay, so number one is the better answer. You're right. Because number one is above the tentorium, and number two is below the tentorium. You've probably been told that you really want to avoid messing around. You don't want to delay with a hematoma in the posterior fossa because there's not that much space there. That's one of the reasons. The other reason is that when people start to herniate from above, there are warning signs. And those warning signs, as you know, are a dilated pupil and paralysis on one side of the body. The warning signs for herniation in the posterior fossa are apnea and asystole. And so we don't have a warning sign. And that's why it's even more important to pick those up early. This is the example of transtentorial herniation, which would happen to the first patient. And this is an example of cerebellar herniation, which would happen to the second patient. Which of these would you rather have? Let's have a show of hands. Who would rather have number one? Who would rather have number two? Okay, now I'm going to do it over again and you have to play. Who would rather have number one? Clap. Number two, clap. Okay, now I can tell you you're wrong. Yeah, the one that you would rather have is this one. This one is worse, okay? This one is worse because it represents active bleeding. And whenever you see two different densities in a hematoma from trauma, that indicates active bleeding. This and this represent active blood. Did you know that? That on CAT scan, before blood is white, it's actually black for the first few moments. This is another example of what we call the Swirl sign. Whenever you see two different densities within a hematoma, your sphincter should be tight. Here's another example. Okay, so those are worse. Anytime there's two densities, it's worse. And that's what the patient looked like at OR. That's what the patient looked like on postmortem examination. Because it's very hard to once you take the brain out, it's very hard to put it back in, I think. Okay, here's another one. Okay, so this is the game. The game is which one is better to have? Which one is less serious? Okay? So I want you to clap for number one. And now clap for number two. And you're all 100% correct, because number one is an epidural hematoma, and number two is a subdural hematoma. And subdural hematomas are always worse, because epidural hematomas are not a brain injury. They are completely outside of the brain. And provided the patient maintains a level of consciousness before the operation, they will do okay. This patient, regardless of the procedures, will never, ever be the same, because subdural is brain injury. It's right next to the brain, and it causes a lot of associated edema. That's why even though you see less white blood here on this picture than you see here, this is the worst injury, because you can see that it's causing all kinds of edema. And that's the hallmark of subdurals. You'll never, ever be the same after a subdural mentally. That's just a picture that shows you that you've seen from medical school on how you can differentiate epidurals from subdurals. Epidurals, of course, cross the midline. Subdurals invaginate into the middle. We're used to seeing subdurals like the one I just showed you with the classic crescent pattern. But remember that an asymmetrical white pattern over the tentorium might represent subdural blood. And if you saw that, you'd have to admit the patient for observation and neurochecks. Here's another example. This is blood that is subdural blood sitting on the tentorium. You can see the asymmetrical white splatter. And the third place that you can find subdural hematomas is in between the two cerebral hemispheres. How do you know that this white that I'm showing you here is not just calcification? Because what did I tell you about subdurals? Subdurals are brain injury, and therefore they cause brain edema. And look at that. This side is very edematous, and this side is very loose. And so now I know that this is a subdural hematoma here. You know, by the way, when I'm looking at CAT scans, I always start at the top and compare side to side, because they get confusing as you go further down CAT scans when you get into these areas where there's a lot of structures. And so when you look at the top, if there's any edema on one side or the other that's different, you'll notice it at the top very clearly. So this is just a summary of what I've just said about subdurals, is that remember, the subdural space is contiguous. And not only does it follow the convexity, but it invaginates in to the midline, and it invaginates to surround and to be above the falx. Okay, so this is the complete territory of the subdural. Okay, the next subject is called respect the fourth ventricle. Here's a woman who comes in with an acute headache. Acute headache in a 64-year-old woman. Would you do a CAT scan? She never had, hang on, I gotta get rid of this thing. She would never do, she comes in with a sudden headache. She's never had a headache before, and now she has an acute headache. Would you do a CAT scan on her? Yes, we all would. And that's what you see. And what does that mean? She has a hemorrhage in her cerebellum, right? What is that? Is that an emergency? Of course it's an emergency, okay? You're gonna call the neurosurgeon, you're gonna scream and jump up and down. You're gonna elevate the head of the bed 30 degrees, right? You might give mannitol. You're gonna do the things that you know how to do, but you gotta get a neurosurgeon there, and you gotta get that skull taken off so that that swelling can occur and that bleeding has a place to go. Everyone here knows that. But what people seem to forget is how important bland infarction, non-hemorrhagic stroke is in the posterior fossa. Take, for example, the 68-year-old man who comes in with acute ataxia. There he is. That's actually Peter Rosen, if you've met him. And in this case, you can see that there is some area here that looks hypodense, okay? Now, I know that it's difficult to look at the cerebellum on a CAT scan because there is a lot of artifact. I understand that. But one thing that you can always see is the fourth ventricle. And you can see in this instance that the fourth ventricle has been deformed, distorted, compressed, and that should indicate that this situation, to be honest, is even more serious than this situation. And this is not noticed by doctors. Emergency doctors don't think about this very often. They just see, oh, I don't see any blood there. If they see blood, they call on the neurosurgeon. If they don't, they don't. That's a mistake. Respect the fourth ventricle. The fourth ventricle should look like this. A nice C on its side. It should not look like this. Here's another patient who has a cerebellar infarct, and it's very difficult to appreciate that. I understand that. But look at this, a deformed, compressed fourth ventricle. Very, very important. Because nothing is going to lead you to herniate faster than an occluded fourth ventricle. How are we doing? Okay? Do I need to talk about penises? No? Can keep talking about the brain? Okay, good. This is a great game, actually. Sometimes, and tell me this doesn't happen sometimes, that people come in unconscious, and you don't know whether or not they had a primary brain event, like a bleed in the brain first, or maybe they had a primary event that was not in the brain, maybe it was in the heart, and they collapsed, and then they had a brain trauma. And sometimes it can be difficult to tell the difference. And is it important to tell the difference? Of course it is. You're gonna die if you don't figure it out. Here's case A. Here's a 47-year-old man who's diabetic who has altered mental status. This is actually a true story. That's actually one of my good friends, Brett Michaels. He's a rock star like me. And maybe not. So anyway, this is his CT. I think he might have showed it on Oprah Winfrey show or something. So look at that CT, what do you see? You see blood all around the base of the brain. You see blood all around the basal cisternae where the circle of Willis is. And so that's a patient that's probably had a subarachnoid hemorrhage. And you can see also the dilated temporal horns, because these temporal horns, to be honest, as they get dilated, and the hydrocephalus that you see will actually kill this patient before the subarachnoid hemorrhage will. And so just as an aside, remember that when you see that temporal horn beginning to swell up, you need to get a ventriculostomy happening within an hour or two, or else it's too late. So here's a picture of the brain. Here's a picture of the CT through the area where the circle of Willis is, and I've outlined it there for you. That's the circle of Willis, and that's where you see aneurysms. There's a close-up, okay? You can actually see it if you look carefully, and I encourage you, after this talk, next time you get a CT, to look for it. Look for the circle of Willis. Look for these structures. And this is what happened with the patient when they got a angiogram. And you can see the aneurysm there. The aneurysm is on the anterior, the aneurysm here is on the anterior communicating artery, which is the commonest spot actually for an aneurysm, and you can see it's bleeding straight from there. I don't do LPs first, by the way. I know that's a controversy, whether you do an LP first or a CT first. I always do the CT first because it gives you the answer most of the time, and not only that, but it gives you more information about edema, and it can actually show you where the aneurysm is itself for the surgeons to plan surgery. How about this case? 72-year-old man is confused and he is lower level of consciousness, and his CAT scan looks like this. In this case, what happened first? Did he fall or did he have an aneurysm burst? He had a fall, and that's we know that because we can see that the blood is on the periphery of the brain, okay, in the sulci, and that's just from direct trauma. Sorry about that. And so that's just a traumatic. So what are we looking for in this gentleman? Are we going to call a neurosurgeon? Maybe, but maybe this is what's going on. Right? So that's a very important thing. So when you have blood around the base of the brain, around the circle of Willis, that's where all the aneurysms are. When you have blood just in the sulci, that's secondary from another event usually. Does that make sense? Everyone got that? Good. All right. Here's another one for you, a little ditty. So a patient that's in a motor vehicle accident, and they just have something very, very small, a very small bleed. In English, we often use the word ditzel. I don't know where it comes from, probably German. But ditzel is a small little bleed. And that's what it looks like. Have you ever seen a CAT scan that looks like that in someone who was in an accident? Of course you have. You see a little bit of hemorrhage and a little bit of edema, and it doesn't impress you. But it should impress you when 2 hours later the patient is dead, right? And that's what happens with these small contusions. And although in medical school and residency, we tend to focus a lot on epidural hematomas and subdural hematomas because they're sexy, the fact of the matter is that many more patients will die because of a failure to recognize the seriousness of cerebral contusions. When you see someone that's in a high mechanism of injury, like a high-speed automobile accident, and they have some findings, and they have a CAT scan that looks like the one on the left, you should expect that it's going to get worse, much worse. How do you tell if it's going to get worse or not? I can't tell you, and this is a big controversy. When you admit the patient to the ward and you put an order for check neurological status every hour, that's what you do, right? You know how that works? This patient is on the left, and he goes to the surgical ward, and in an hour, the nurses check him, and she sees that he's not responding, and one pupil is big. So what does she or he do? Call the neurosurgeon comes in, the neurosurgeon calls the operating room. This patient's dead, forget about it. It doesn't work. Doing neuro checks 1 hour, I'm not telling you to stop writing that order, but realize that when the stakes are high, it's not good enough. It's not good enough. And so other things have been proposed for patients that have significant brain injury, but just a small amount of blood. One thing that is proposed is to put a monitor in, to just drill a hole and put a pressure monitor in. And if the pressure is going up, then it's a sign that something's wrong. Let me explain how that works in real life. The patient has the CT on the left, and the neurosurgeon puts in the little monitor, and the pressure is 20, 20, 20, 40, 60, 80. And then what happens? The nurse calls the neurosurgeon, and the neurosurgeon comes in, and the neurosurgeon calls the OR, and the patient's dead. The only way to avoid this problem, we have found, is to repeat all the CTs. and to repeat all the CTs probably within the first few hours. Because if there's going to be massive swelling, it's probably going to be evident after the first couple of hours. So we typically, in a patient like this, will do another CAT scan 2 or 3 hours, 4 hours later. If the patient looks totally fine, and it's a kid, and they've got a neurological exam is normal, and they have this CT, it is acceptable to observe them. But as patients get older, and as patients have some alteration of consciousness or some findings, they don't look right or they're vomiting, you need to be more aggressive about repeating the CT earlier. Because you know what, the neurosurgeon's gonna go and they're gonna take that out, and that patient's gonna survive, otherwise they will die. Okay, I got just a couple more for you. We'll finish on time. This one is something that we see all the time. Patient comes in and they've got a shunt and you want to know if it's working. Now, we all know how to tell the difference between hydrocephalus and normal. That's not the question. The question is, what do you do with so many of the children that we have? And this is very common in South and Central America. It's also very common in Los Angeles. A lot of our patients have shunts placed for neurocysticercosis. If you have this patient and you see the shunt is in the ventricle, is it working? What do you think? It's a very hard question to answer. I'm not even going to ask you to clap or do anything else silly, because how do you know if it's working? It's in the ventricle. It looks like the ventricles are still very big, so it looks like it's not working. To me, it looks like it's not working initially. But unless you compare it to what that patient has had previously, you cannot know for sure. You simply cannot know. So you need to have a baseline. So unless you see the shunt in the right place, ventricles that are slim and normal, unless you see both of those things, you have to err on the side of consulting the neurosurgeon, and you have to err on the side of being aggressive, because people will die from hydrocephalus in a few hours, okay? This is a sign that you have to be comfortable with, and it's a really serious sign. This patient had a shunt study, had a CT to see if their shunt was in the right place, and the patient was getting unconscious. And look what we see here. And I believe this patient is in their 20s. Around the ventricles, we see an area that is darker. This is one of the most scary things that you can ever see on a CAT scan. And it reflects the fact that the pressure is so intense that rather than going down, the CSF has nowhere to go, it starts to diffuse through the brain parenchyma itself. Not good. And so be aware of this sign. That's transependymal edema. And that's one of the signs, a very serious signs of a shunt malfunction. Now here's a last case for you. There's some audience participation here. And then afterwards, I think we will have a couple minutes for questions. This is a patient who's 55 years old and he's Asian. And he has a history of high blood pressure and he has an acute headache and vomiting. You don't see as many Asian patients as we do. But one thing I should tell you about Asian patients, whether they're Chinese or Filipino or Japanese, when they come in with a headache, take them very seriously. And they have a rate of bleeding in their head that is at least 2 times what a Caucasian or Hispanic population has. And so that's kind of interesting. So you're already suspicious that she might have a bleed. And she has a history of high blood pressure, which, as you know, is the biggest risk factor for bleeding in your head. And that's, or I keep mixing the gender up. But anyway, that's what the CAT scan looks like. And what I asked you at the beginning was, does this patient need an angiogram? Now, we already saw patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage. And when we see blood in the brain, one of the most important things to check first is it from an aneurysm? Because if it is, intervention needs to be immediate, because the risk of rebleeding is very high, especially after the initial bleed. And so one of the critical questions you need to know when someone is bleeding in the brain is this an aneurysm, or is this just bleeding that's coming from changes to the brain from long-standing hypertension and diabetes? Which one is this, folks? It's deep in the brain, and where is it, by the way? It's in the area around the third ventricle, which is the thalamus, okay? And I can tell you with almost 100% certainty that this patient does not need an angiogram or a CT angiogram. They just need to go to the neuro ICU, and they have medical management. There's no neurosurgical intervention here. And that's because this is one of the classic sites for hypertensive hemorrhage. Another classic, this looks terrible, doesn't it? It looks terrible. But there's not much the neurosurgeon can do about this except for what? Look here and look here. What can the neurosurgeon do? A ventriculostomy. But beyond that, there's no other surgical intervention. This is a hypertensive bleed that started in the basal ganglia. And so you need to know these areas of the brain, basal ganglia, thalamus, I pointed out. And it just went from there and it went into the ventricles. But this is not aneurysmal. This is a hypertensive hemorrhage. And there's no angiogram necessary. The neurosurgeon can't clip an aneurysm. This is just a patient that only the intervention that we can do, the only intervention that we can do is to put a ventriculostomy, and then their medical management. And I want to leave you with something very tangible, because I know that you see a lot of patients like this. I know a lot of patients come in, a lot of older patients come in. I remember at Sotero seeing patient after patient after patient with hypertensive and diabetic bleeds, right? And so you need to know with confidence when you see these patients, are these medical patients? Are these aneurysmal surgical patients? And the way you know is that if it's in one of these classic sites, it's a hypertensive or diabetic hemorrhage. You don't need to do an angio and you don't need to consult. And so what I've done, I've had Oscar translate those, and I want to leave you with something, and I know it's a little silly, but I want everyone to repeat after me these four sites, because if you repeat them and you memorize them, it will make this more fun, because you'll be able to. And you know what? The thing about this, just like anything else, maybe you were bad with EKGs when you started, and you got good, and now you love them. Maybe you don't feel too comfortable with head CTs. You're like I explained, I see blood or no blood, and I call a neurosurgeon. But your job will be much more fun, and you'll be a much better doctor if you start to get more interested in it. And so this is worth knowing. So I want everyone to repeat after me. Ganglios de la base. Tálamo, cerebelo, y por supuesto, la puente. Okay, and those are the four sites that you must memorize, and those are the four classic sites of hypertensive hemorrhage. If it is not one of those sites, you must get an angiogram, and you must eliminate the possibility of aneurysm, and you must call a neurosurgeon. The last image I have for you is another type of bleeding that you get in the brain. And I want you to be sure to recognize this as different from the other two types we've talked about. Let's summarize. We talked about aneurysm bleeds. We talked about the bleeds that you get from long-standing high blood pressure and diabetes. This is a third type of bleeding, right? This is a patient who has blood exclusively in the distribution of the middle cerebral artery. They're trying to get me to join the faculty at PUC. That's what it keeps putting that up, right? And I put in my clave, and I'm going to be a professor of PUC. So this here is middle cerebral artery territory, right? This wedge here. And you need to know that. The front wedge is the anterior cerebral artery. The middle wedge is the middle cerebral artery. And the posterior wedge is the posterior cerebral artery. This patient had a normal, regular AVE, a normal, regular stroke, okay, that then started to bleed. And you guys know that the bigger the stroke, the more likely it is to bleed and the more dangerous. And so this is, of course, one of the reasons why we're so worried about tissue plasminogen activator, or TPA, because if a patient just has a tiny, tiny bit of bleeding that even the neuroradiologist doesn't pick up, they can look like this a couple of hours later after you give anticoagulation or TPA. And so recognize that this patient doesn't need an angiogram. We know where the blood is coming from. It's a secondary transformation from an ischemic stroke, okay? But this patient does need a neurosurgeon because the blood is so close to the surface of the skull, they're likely to go and take that half of the skull off. When the blood is deeper, as is the case with the hypertensive hemorrhages, neurosurgeons can't do anything because it's too dangerous to go deep into the brain. But when blood comes to the surface, they'll consider it. Thanks a lot.
Muchas gracias, doctor Suadro.
Reanimación.
Compañerismo.
Servicio.
Cuidado al paciente.
Control del caos.
Pasión.
Pura buena onda. Trabajo.
vigilia,
conocimiento, muy buena pega,
adrenalina, equipo, control de la incertidumbre,
lo mejor.
Yo soy Urgencia UC.
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 Yo soy Urgencia UC. Posturno.
Muy bien. La siguiente charla nos dará una perspectiva acerca del desarrollo de la medicina de urgencias en el país. Para esto invitamos al escenario al doctor Patricio Yacaman, jefe del Servicio de Urgencias del Hospital Clínico de la Pontificia Universidad Católica de Chile, profesor asociado a la misma universidad. ¿También todo? ¿Sí?